Welcome to Blades and Blasters for a one-shot of the Bok'Toth Reach. This is using Star Trek Adventures, specifically the Star Trek Adventures Klingon Core Rulebook that just came out a couple weeks ago. It uses mostly the same rules, but comes from a totally different perspective, obviously, of Klingons, and we will be playing Klingons tonight. With me today, I have Slip as Talaha, Raven as Epic, Wander as Kalesh, and Matt as Yudaza. And we will get started now. I will share a handout. Actually, I won't quite yet. You have, actually, I want to show this to, I'm going to give you a handout slip and you can, read it if you would like. It is, kind of your commander's log.
Okay.
I'll just show it to everybody so they can read it.
Ah, there we go.
I have determined that it is time for my crew to take its rightful place among the Empire's most revered warriors. Accordingly, we have decided to travel to Bok'Toth Reach to receive the blessing of the legendary Oracle there. The journey through the asteroid field has claimed the lives of countless Klingon warriors over the decades, but the few who have entered the Oracle's temple and heard her wisdom have earned great honor for themselves, their houses, and the Empire. I have no doubt we are equal to the task. The Oracle will have no choice but to grant us her blessing, and word of our courageous deeds will spread throughout the Empire. Kapla!
Did that not go through?
No, it did.
Okay.
I was muted, sorry. Yeah, I'm about to switch a scene for you guys. Give me one sec. Do you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. One second, I don't. Do you see? I just see blackness. His sight. Matt, do you see this? Do you see the?
Yeah, I see everything.
Why don't I? Elimination. Bear with me. You guys see everything. Hold on. So you are on the bridge heading to Bok'Toth Reach. You are standing about, you're in hyperspace heading there, and I'll let you guys roleplay amongst yourself. It's been each of your desire to do this for some time. Yudaza, you have You have joined the crew basically before you went on this expedition. The Chancellor wanted you to go, and her administration had booked you passage on this ship to go with the captain because they want to know the current situation there, and you're to basically report on what you see to the Chancellor. And I will let you guys roleplay amongst yourselves.
Talaha is doing some last minute checking in on, you know, the different senior officers, making sure that everything was shipshape and ready to go. But she keeps shooting Udaza some narrow-eyed glances. She knows the official reason Udaza's here, but she approaches Udaza and crosses her arms across her chest.
Girl, you know I don't need a babysitter no matter what the Chancellor says.
And Udaza had been working on some scans and such, and she spins around in her chair, looks to Talaha.
You understand exactly why I am here. This is what was ordered. This is what will happen.
I have proved myself capable. I don't need anyone looking over my shoulder.
It seems that you do.
Watch yourself, girl. Space can be a dangerous place.
I fully understand.
With that, she kind of nods warily and goes back, approaches Epic.
Uncle, we must make sure that this journey goes as smoothly as possible. That girl, she is the Chancellor's eyes and ears.
Of course. We'll make sure everything meets the Chancellor's approval.
One way or another, the Chancellor should only get positive news of this journey.
Meanwhile, Kalesh is sitting at his post and he's ostensibly looking up historical records about their destination, but actually he's surreptitiously keeping a careful eye on the power politics here. By default he'll back the captain, but you know, if there's a good chance that the Chancellor's representative might be a better bet, he'll bear that in mind. So he's just watching carefully for the moment.
Kalesh, have you given Captain. Everything a final look over? We cannot afford any mistakes. We cannot overlook anything that needs last-minute maintenance.
I do not make mistakes, Captain. You know this. Everything will be fine.
Such has been my experience up until now, which is why you remain my chief science officer and alive.
Yes, Captain. I am intrigued by our destination. I would leave nothing to chance.
It's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I am disappointed to share it with this outsider, but I will not let it spoil this journey. I know that the Oracle will have... She will see greatness for us.
Of course, Captain. We will win great honor here. I am looking forward to it.
And he smiles a really sort of toothy grin.
She smiles back, equally toothy, retreats back to the captain's chair. All right, then. No more delays. Engage.
You begin your approach to the Bakoth Reach, and one moment. You come out of light speed and you immediately see a huge asteroid belt in front of you. You've dropped out of warp near the Bakoth Reach and a massive asteroid field crowds your view screen. Moments later, everyone on the bridge feels a prickly sensation on their skin. The sensation intensifies until it becomes overwhelming. Suddenly, every warrior instrument reading on the bridge moves backwards to where it was several moments earlier before the prickly sensation dissipates and normal bridge activity resumes. It was as if everything on board the ship shifted backward in time for a few seconds before the normal passage of time reasserted itself.
Tala looks around her in alarm. What just happened? Kalesh!
I am already scanning, my captain.
I'm going to start.
Yeah, you can. Go ahead and give me a reason and science assisted by the ship's sensors and science. So what you can do is just click on your token for now and then do a reason plus science task.
I've got task science and then, oh yeah, select reason there. Mm-hmm. Okay. Dice pool, just d20?
Well, you're going to do a 2d20 and you don't have any momentum. You can buy momentum with threat. That would give me an extra threat and momentum. The difficulty of this is 1, so you need 1 success. So make sure you do 2d20.
Okay, let's just try this. Difficulty is 1, right?
Yes. Okay, go ahead and roll the ship. So click on the ship and do a science plus reason. Or I'm sorry, science plus sensors.
Okay. Sensors. Science.
Okay. So you have 1 momentum. You added 1 momentum there because you rolled 2 successes and you only need 1. Anything left over is adds to your momentum pool. And I will add that now. And I would, you can do things like on this, you can do things like obtain information, which will give you more information about the what you find out. But I will let you know right now. So when you do the scan, Kalesh, you realize there's a increased ambient chronoton levels throughout this asteroid field, and it seems to be causing temporal anomalies to swirl around the asteroids. You're able to scan these and tell that they like flicker in and flicker out all around in front of you, and you're guessing that's what happened. And so temporal anomalies is, you know, some sort of time disturbance.
Is it possible to plot a safe course through, or does the fact they flicker in and out mean it's going to be impossible?
You think that it will be difficult, but not impossible. Some people have visited the Oracle in these asteroids. You figure that that is probably why it's so difficult.
Right. Yes, so Kalesh will turn to his captain and say,
Captain, I am reading high chronoton levels, temporal disturbances. It will be difficult to make our way through, but I think we are equal to the task.
Of course we are. See if you can ascertain a pattern.
Yes, Captain.
And, I'll see what I can do about plotting a course.
Yeah, whoever wants to plot a course, make me a reason plus con, assisted by the ship's sensors plus science.
Can I assist with command at all, or is that something different?
How does that read? That is something different. If you have a task that allows you to do that, then you can.
Okay. It's a specific sort of a thing, though.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, so that was reason, science.
Yeah, and reason plus con. So whoever's good at flying the ship probably should make it. Maybe. Reason plus con, you tell me, right?
My cons, yeah. Who normally flies the ship?
The ship flies itself.
Well, some of you have good con, I will say that, right?
I've got 2 con. Not 4. Okay.
You want to pass that if you fly the ship?
Udaza, I have read your file. You seem to have some skill in this area. I will let you take over and show yourself to be of some use.
Killed that many, it seems. And Udaza goes over and she will navigate. And you said reason plus con, right?
Yep. Difficulty
use the momentum
two.
If you need to.
Yeah, you have 1 momentum to spend if you would like. And you have the ship's sensors plus science as well.
There's a tower. Mm,
I think I'll be okay.
Difficulty 2.
Maybe not. I'll use a momentum.
Okay.
Have anything, any values or anything for this?
Yeah, do you have any foci?
Yeah, that's what I mean. Sorry, I don't have any. Yep. I don't have any.
Yeah, probably not.
Focus for this, no. Oh, I didn't even scroll down to that. No.
Okay, go ahead and roll the ship computer. That would be for it. It's sensors plus science. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you think you might have a way through, but you're kind of unsure. You've never experienced anything like this before, so.
Udaza is flying through. She's tapping away, trying to get enables the Heisenberg hologrid to try and get a great way of getting through this field. Unfortunately, it's extremely complicated. Everything's very dense. She glances back. And sorry, is it captain or commander?
I believe they're commanders, technically.
Commander, it seems the way through this field is quite difficult. It is not something that has been encountered before in my history.
Others have made it through and returned to tell the tale, and so we must. Duty and honor demands it.
Of course, Commander.
And Udaza will attempt to do her best to make it through. Who's on weapons?
That would be Epic.
Commander, would it be viable in case any asteroids get too close for Epic to shoot them apart, make it easier for our travel?
I see these temporal anomalies might make it difficult to predict when something is in the way. Epic, make sure that you are on weapons, ready to fire.
Grins widely. Kapla!
Yeah, if you want to try to navigate, go ahead and give me a control plus con. Difficulty 3.
Oh my goodness. Alright.
Is it possible to just blast some of the asteroids?
Yeah, the asteroids isn't the problem. It's the temporal anomalies that you have to go around. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because they keep fritzing in and out. It's quite difficult.
And so we can give you threat, right?
Yeah, you can give me some threat. One threat for one die, three threat for two die, six threat for three die.
Even two threat, or sorry, three threat for two extra die.
All right. Oh, God! I wanted to do that so bad.
Do I roll the ship as well? Then?
No, there's no ship. Mm-mm. Not for that one. So you gain one momentum. Oh, I was hoping you failed so bad. Just to let you know, if you would have failed, we would have started over from her reading the commander log again. Oh, to go back in time.
Oh.
All right. I interpret that threat as being really close to some anomalies and just last minute.
Actually, I'm going to spend some threat real quick. So why don't you describe how you go through all these temporal anomalies? They're popping up everywhere. You're able to move the ship just in time around asteroids through these anomalies until you see this domed outpost in a hollowed out asteroid as you get in through past all this stuff.
Daza, though she's not used to this sort of these temporal fields and the asteroids around, she switches from half impulse to quarter to full multiple times, attempting to just dodge out of the way, the ship spinning and turning, barely scraping along any of the asteroids that spin through space as they go, and finally dodging in and out of the way of the different temporal effects. They finally make it across, see this outpost.
As you reach this outpost, Epic, you suddenly realize that there's a massive asteroid coming towards you on your starboard side. What would you do?
He would brace for impact, and then he would try and shoot it.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a con plus security roll. Assisted by the ship's weapons and security. Difficulty is 2.
What was the roll?
It would be control and security.
Focus. Probably hand weapons. So no. And the difficulty?
2. Ooh, go ahead and give me a. You can go ahead and roll the ship's weapons and security as well. Although, I don't think you can succeed. Man, what rolls? Those are terrible.
How could you?
Yeah, Epic shoots, and you're either surprised or just not a very good shot. And the asteroid just smashes into your hull of your ship, and you just... And you hear this... the alarm klaxon goes off as there's damage reports throughout the ship. And I would at least like you to each take three challenge dice worth of stress. So there is a roll challenge dice on your token. And please roll that as you get knocked around. And then just subtract it from your red token bubble, whatever you get. And go ahead and describe how you get thrown about.
Epec clings to the weapons station as the ship rocks from the impact, tries to maintain his grip.
Udaza, she's in the pilot's chair, and of course the ship gets rocked. Maybe one of the other stationed on the actual bridge smacks into her at one point. She maintains grip of the chair, keeping her in place.
Talaha curses and calls out, Kalesh, damage report!
Kalesh had was kind of ready to strap himself in at all along, because he realized how difficult this was. And as soon as it hit, he was already running a damage report. So what do I discover?
Whatever you would like it to be. Nothing overall significant to the ship, but it's going to take some repairs.
Okay. Yeah. So
the hull plating has lost polarity in three sections. We have three decks reporting damage, but it can be repaired.
Talas kind of snarls and then nods. Get your junior officers on it. It could have been worse. Fortune favors the bold. That was good flying, Udaza. Glory to your household.
She grunts and will continue flying. Is Impulse online? Or?
Yeah. You have it's fully functional. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she just keeps flying, maintaining vigilance for any other incoming asteroids.
Yeah, at this point, the asteroids are coming in slow enough that Epic and his security officers are able to shoot them before they hit, or you're able to fly around them. It's not a problem. You see that clearly what the Oracle's base in this hollowed out asteroid is before you now.
Udaza glances back. Commander, shall we find a landing zone or beam aboard?
I am not certain that they have that capability. She says, Kalesh, scan for an appropriate place to beam down.
Yes.
Yeah, you can do that.
Try and find somewhere very, very smooth. Don't really want to get jolted when we got damaged. So,
yeah, go ahead and give me a reason plus science assisted by the ship's sensors plus science.
Dice pool.
Two. It's always two unless you spend momentum.
Oh, okay, cool. What was it assisted by again? The ships?
Sensors plus science. You scan the base and you see that it's powered by a fusion generator, and it has life support, artificial gravity, and some defense shields, but nothing significant, really just to keep large asteroids from colliding with it. But it wouldn't stand very long versus a disruptor barrage or anything like that. So it's completely safe to beam down if you would like.
Defenses are minimal. We should be safe to beam down.
No temporal anomalies here that would possibly interfere with the function of the transporter.
Oh, there's... Yeah, you would know that there definitely is the temporal anomalies are all around still. The chronotons are still, they're everywhere, so you would have to successfully work the transporter to beam down for sure.
It will be challenging, but we will succeed.
In your opinion, would it, which has a greater sense of success, a shuttle or transporter?
Do I have a particular opinion on that? Is it going to be easier to just beam?
You think that either will be difficult. Especially with the damage already sustained to the ship, flying in close might suscept it to more damage.
Do we have any shuttles, though?
Yes. Same, yeah, but if you, one of those got hit by an asteroid, you would be completely obliterated and killed.
But then again, I guess if a transporter went wrong, would be killed as well, so...
Maybe.
He weighs up the odds and says,
I think we should transport, Captain.
Oh, he should say Commander, shouldn't he? Yeah.
Yeah, she narrows her eyes at the Captain. Just kidding. let
us prepare ourselves. Epic. Make sure you are properly attired as my security officer.
Grabs his Batleth and his disruptor. Of course, Commander.
Talaha straps hers on as well.
It will be me, you, Kalesh, and of course our guest, Udaza.
So I guess we're putting someone else on the transporter, or can we like set it to go and then
you can set it to go and then transport down.
Yeah, Talaha will make sure that whoever would be the next person to take temporary command of the ship is in place, and
we are ready.
To transport down, I need a reason plus science task, assisted by sensors and science.
I can give that a go.
Yep.
Okay.
Difficulty 2.
Okay. Reason, science. D2. And as usual, by the time I flick through that, I forget what the other thing was.
Sensors and science.
Thanks.
Oh. So you got it.
Yep.
Yeah, you're able to beam down. The transporter sound, let's see if I can find it. This is my big problem. Got too many of them. Switch the scene for you guys. You beam down into this room. It has various equipment, general stuff. Very old, extremely old from what you can tell. And I'll let you roleplay as you materialize without a problem.
Epic quickly looks around for any source of threat.
You don't currently see anything.
Kalesh hides any sense of relief he might be feeling and just tries to look completely confident as they materialize, and then just glances very briefly to the captain to make sure that she saw that he was successful once again.
She gives a brief nod of approval and takes her right hand off of her back lath, which she was also halfway expecting to use, looks around. What sort of readings are we getting? I assume we have, like, some sort of tricorder.
Yeah, there's some, I don't know what it would be called, but yeah, you have a science scanning device of some sort. Probably looks like a huge tape recorder for you guys. And yeah, you can scan with a reason plus science.
I'll give that a go. For once, Kalesh wasn't actually doing it ahead of time because he was busy congratulating himself.
I did it.
Yeah, difficulty?
2.
2.
Yeah, you're able to tell that the chronotons are decaying.
I will report this to the others. This does appear to be, although the field here is strong, it is decaying. Chronotons fading.
What does that mean?
I am. And actually, before he says he doesn't know, is there anything he would understand from
you,
that?
As you, yeah, you're thinking about it, and all of a sudden you see, like, in front of you appears this Klingon, and he rushes right at you, Kalesh, and he's got his batleth in his hands, and he goes to swing it, and as he does, he disappears suddenly, and just out of thin air, he's just gone.
Kalesh snarled at the challenge and braced himself to face this enemy. Far better this than have to admit to his captain he didn't know what was going on. And he braced himself, and then as the enemy disappears, he snarls in frustration.
Yping swings his battle through the empty space.
Chronotons. Not a ghost, not a spirit from the past. Time here is strange.
You can give me an insight and command, anyone who wants to. Difficulty 2.
I've been doing lots of rolls recently. I'll let someone else.
Yeah, probably better for somebody else too. Oh, there we go. Finally, a good roll. You can too. I'll let 2 of you roll. That's fine. All right, you failed anyway. So you gain 1 momentum from that. And Matt, I will whisper you something. I should probably be doing whispers.
As Udaza, she mentally assesses what happened with the Klingon coming and going, basically, in almost an instant. She turns to the rest. She turns to the captain. Did you notice his gear, what he was wearing?
No. What was significant?
Significance of this commander was that no one has worn those that garb in over 100 years.
That makes sense in a way. Perhaps there are more of these distortions here that mix the past with the present. I hope we do not run the risk of being caught as well.
Let's step lightly.
Kalesh, keep your readings fresh. Keep a constant look in case something not visible to the eye, but able to be read on the sensors.
Nods and goes to his sort of tricorder equivalent.
Where's a door out or in?
Right in front of you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Talaha will move toward the door and then look over at Epek.
You will have the honor of first entry, Uncle.
Draws his disruptor. My pleasure. Proceed to the door. Any trick to opening the door?
No, it just, as you get, there's a button, just like every time. You hit the button and it just opens. You don't see anything in there besides a lot of archaic equipment that isn't easily recognizable to you, at least.
This place looks as old as that warrior's garb.
Tala looks around. It looks old, but does it look unused?
It looks pretty unused, yeah. Everything is covered in dust.
I hope we have not come here in vain and that the Oracle still resides.
Kalesh, as you get in there, you see that there's this massive machine. And it has some blinking lights, but seems to be dimmed. And you're not sure what it is, but it does draw your attention.
Is there any kind of control panel or information?
There is a control panel, and you can try to figure out what it is with a reason plus engineering task, difficulty 3. You have 2 momentum in the pool.
Difficulty 3. Okay, can I use a momentum?
Yes, and that'll give you a 3d10.
And I've got a focus in ancient Klingon tech.
Yes, that, so, yep.
Okay. And difficulty is 3.
Yeah, you're not sure what this thing does. You're fascinated by it because of your interest in ancient Klingon technology, but you're not sure what it is.
Kalesh is sort of has his head down over this, and he doesn't want to give up. He's gonna keep going at it until they have to leave the room. But he was he's starting to realize he's not going to learn anything. But he keeps going.
Yeah, as you continue to mess with this thing, you all hear. From the room from behind you, as you hear something, a door open, and you hear this snarling.
Draw my disruptor.
Might as well, yes, sir.
Yeah.
We'll move back towards the doorway.
Talaha also. I guess she's in the back, so she pulls out her disruptor.
So.
And it's Udaza. Did the door close behind us?
No. And oops. You recognize, as you kind of peer through the door, that there are six targs heading in your direction.
Alright. I think Udaza would just stand her ground and open fire then.
Okay. We can do do some fighting. Go ahead. You guys go first. I'm not going to spend any threat to take the initiative or anything, so...
Okay. So Udaza's going to fire at... she's got easy sight on probably this one here.
Yeah, within reason, anybody is fine.
And she'll raise up her disruptor rifle and fire. And that would be...
It should be automatically worked into your macro. It's control plus security, but... And you, I think you have focus, so...
Yeah, is there a difficulty or no?
It's already worked in. If you click on that, if you click on attack phaser, it's always two, so you miss. You shoot and it goes high and it just puts a big hole in the wall behind the targ. Who wants to go next? What is it? Hold on, accurate lets you re-roll a d20, so go ahead and roll one d20 for me. That's what that does. That's a miss.
Nope.
Yep. Still miss. Who's up?
Okay. Eatpeck will take a shot.
Yep.
Now he does have a focus and disruptors.
Yep. Oh, complication and, so, you hit one. Go ahead and click on roll damage. 8. It has vicious, I believe, so that's actually 11 damage. You can... so, that puts it down pretty far. It's not dead. Which one did you shoot, by the way?
This middle guy.
Okay. The 3. Okay. So, he's down pretty good. You can spend a momentum. You have one momentum already in the pool to re-roll one of your blank... All blank die, actually. So, you could do 2 combat dice if you wanted. Or effect dice, I guess is what they're called. Challenge dice, I think. If you want, or not.
Okay, so click on the roll challenge die.
Yeah, and you would pick 2. Yeah, that kills it. How does it look as you disintegrate this thing?
Nothing fancy. Just a shot that burns through its shoulder. Gets to the vitals.
Yeah, I mean, it disappears. It's like you hit it and it disappears. Just melts.
Oh, that's right.
Melts away.
So, yeah, disrupts. Yeah.
Yep. And as you do that, the complication is you shoot... And you realize that something, you feel the heat in the gun, in the disruptor, and it's like essentially the equivalent of jammed, and you're going to have to spend your next turn to get it to function properly.
Swears in Klingon.
Kalish and Talah, you're up. Talah, ha.
This is a pretty narrow opening. I mean, how...
Yep.
Like, we can't really, in the back here, reasonably fire past everybody. That's the way I'm reading.
You probably don't have an angle. If there was something right in front of you, yeah, you could. But you don't have an angle, probably, to do so. You can move, though. Move and attack is a thing. You can definitely do that.
Yeah, she sees Udaza and Epic firing, and... While tactically she thinks backing up and making them funnel through this opening would probably be smarter, she knows that a leader must show courage, and so she moves forward to get a better shot, and she'll shoot at this guy.
Okay.
Uh, Okay, if she's got a focus, it's 3d20?
No, you rolled 2d20. It's going to be 2d20 unless you spend momentum or give me threat.
Oh, yeah, there's the drop down for focus.
Yeah, okay. Focus, basically, if you're under your discipline, it counts as two successes. But you missed, so okay. You don't have accurate on that thing. So your disruptor pistol misses over the head of the target, snarls. Kalesh, you're up.
Okay, so Kalesh is now finding he hasn't got a shot, so he's going to try and squeeze through here.
Mm-hmm.
Next to the commander. And take a shot at this one here, number one.
Okay.
I don't think I've got any... Oh, now I've got disruptors as a focus.
Yep,
is that...
that's good.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead and roll damage. That's a hit. 7.
It's vicious.
It is vicious, so that's 10. Yeah, you hit it, and it... as you hit it in kind of the side, but it doesn't... These things, you know targs, right? They're kind of like pets slash dog fighting pigs things. I don't know how to describe other than that. And they're very hardy, and it hits it and just and as you do it, it charges you and attacks with its tusk. It misses. It tries to gore you and misses. The Targ 2 comes over to Talaha and does the same thing, tries to gore her. It also misses. Wait, what? No, that can't be right. Hold on. Daring 1? I think it's supposed to be Daring 10. Oh. Yes, yes it is. It's very hard to... So that was a 12. That's a 16. That's going to miss. That's a 7, and that's a 15. They both still missed, but... Hold on, let me fix their stats. I was like, wait, they're the worst thing ever.
They're just intimidated by us.
Yeah.
Targwawas.
Alright. Yeah, this one comes up and is going to attack. I'm going to change its stats real quick. This one tries to bite you. With a phaser.
Amazing.
This one tries to bite Kalesh. Excuse my shoddy macro work. Two, that's a hit. 6 damage. I'm gonna assume you all have resistance 1 at least for let me look at something real quick. Never mind. So it hits you for 6 damage. How does that look as it bites into your leg?
That was on me, right?
Yep. And this one can't get through, so
yeah.
It's
really... So then they had it kind of crowd forward, and Kalesh had focused too much on the first target and was taking it for granted, and the other one just rushed in. It's bit through, and there's a kind of crunching noise as it goes through his sort of thick uniform. And he yells more in anger than in pain as the blood starts to flow.
We all have Bracklil, to resistance against all non-lethal attacks. Or
yeah, yes, but these are lethal attacks.
Ah, gotcha.
Yeah, yeah. You all have the Klingon trait. That's what that is. But you guys are up.
Not have to. Do we go in order, or can we just?
You can go whenever you want. It's like Conan.
Well, I think Talaz gonna try to move in to give other people a shot. And which one had? Oh, didn't matter. She'll... How long would it take to drop the pistol and pull out the batlet?
I'll give it to you for free.
She just kind of drops the pistol and whips out the batleth and makes a strike against Targ 2.
Okay, go ahead.
All right, opportunity and escalation. I don't know what those do.
Don't worry about that. Those are something that's not important for now.
All right, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Is that right?
Because
of the vicious?
Yes, it is. So which one did you attack? 2?
2.
Yep. Make sure these things don't have resistance. It's okay if they don't. Okay, so yeah, you hit it. It doesn't kill it, but you slice it across the upper back, and it... Blood goes flying. Who's next?
I might as well clear some space. So, Kalesh throws his disruptor over here. And then gets himself down into almost a wrestling position and tries to tackle this Targ in front of him and drive it backwards towards where his disruptor is.
Okay, go ahead and give me a... just give me a fitness security roll.
Okay. Anything? Nope. Difficulty?
1. Yeah, you're able to do that.
So yeah, I just drive it over there and just try and get around here to kind of make a space for the others to come through. If I can drive it ahead of me.
Yeah, this one. Yeah, you kind of just... How does it look as you just like bowl it over?
Yeah, so he kind of gets down in a low, almost wrestling position. Then he just roars at it and just kind of like pull on kind of the Klingon equivalent of like a rugby tackle, a football tackle, and just... drives it backwards. He kind of, it's snarling, he's yelling, and he's obviously having the time of his life.
All right, who's up next?
Ipek will just jam his overheated disruptor into its holster and charge Targ 5, swinging his batleth.
Yeah, you can do that. Good, and give me a roll.
I've got attack unarmed.
It's probably it.
Focus and blades, yes.
That's vicious too. Let me make sure it's correct on your sheet. No, it's... Hold on. That's a fine roll because they use the same, but let me fix this. Did I not? Go on your sheet, and then just... do you see where the batlef is on your sheet?
Yep.
Just click where it's next to the 8. Now it should roll damage. It doesn't look like a button, but it's the pink. I don't know what you would call it.
I clicked it, but it's popped up the whole.
Oh, that's fine. Okay, so just tick roll damage. Okay, so that does 10 damage. Which one did you attack? 2.
Number 5.
5. Okay. So yeah, you cut it across its neck, and it's like, but doesn't fall. Udaza.
She will fire. He's engaged with that one.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm gonna do Targ 4. Mm-hmm. She's gonna fire a disruptor rifle at that one.
Okay.
But roll, I'd roll 3d20 because of the accurate, right?
No, you re-roll if you want.
Oh, gotcha.
Okay, you gain one momentum there. And that's a hit. Go ahead and roll damage. Oh, you did? 8.
Yep. Right.
So it's 11 damage right off the bat. Okay, you could spend a momentum to re-roll those die, or... Doesn't kill it.
I'll spend a momentum to roll 2 of the dice then.
Okay.
Hey.
Yeah, it disintegrates. How does it look?
She aims down the sights of her disruptor rifle and fires at the targ straight in front of her, and it just melts right behind Kalesh, sinking to the grate below.
As you do this, this targ comes in on Epic and tries to gore him. That's a miss. Targ 2 tries to attack the commander with a bite. Six. Yeah, that's actually going to be a hit because I didn't do a focus. So that's going to be 2 successes. Yeah. So it's a hit. Damage. 8 damage. Resistance of 1. 7 damage. Yeah, it, like, bites you in the leg. Starts tearing at your flesh.
This targ just is chewing on her leg, and she braces to try to slice it while not slicing off her leg.
Yeah, the other targ goes after Epic with a tusk attack. Oh no, gives me a threat. And I roll damage. And it's not very much. 3 damage, 2 gets through. Yeah, it just barely nicks you, Epic. But these things are getting savage now. And the one on Kalesh, as it's getting kind of wrestled around, it tries to bite you in the shoulder, kind of like the R.E.O.S.S. from Princess Bride. Hit. Only 1 damage gets through. How does that look as it barely nicks you? As it's your guess's turn after that. Exactly.
I think Kala's gonna try to kill this target.
Yeah, go ahead.
Try to shake it off and take a swipe at it.
Please do. It's a hit. Go ahead and roll damage.
Bad roll, but
6 damage. That's enough to kill it.
She, with one swift jerk of her leg, she kicks it off and slices its throat with the batleth, turning to face Targ 5 while not able to put full pressure on her damaged leg.
Alright, who's next?
Epic, seeing that the commander has dispatched the one that was chewing on her, will try and finish off 5 here.
It's a hit. That's enough to kill it.
He spikes it in the back of the neck with his batleth.
Yeah, you just see the point of the batleth come out the underside of its neck as you just run it through.
Kalesh has now pushed this Targ far enough back that he can pick up his disruptor again. So he picks up the disruptor, and if he can, I don't know.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Turn. He's going to roll to over here, mm-hmm. and then come up from the roll and then shoot it.
Go for it. That's a hit. Go ahead and roll damage. That is not a lot of damage. It's only 4. You can, yeah, you can't spend a threat on that one. So yeah, you hit it, but it's not a very good hit, not a very solid hit.
You're busy rolling about.
Yeah. Yudaza, what are you going to do?
She's going to fire at this last Targ that looks to be snarling at Ipek.
Yep.
And take it out.
Hit, roll damage. Dead.
Very nice. That thing just melting as well, turning to dust beside the peck.
And as if there's only one Targ left, it charges Kalesh and is going to attack. I'm going to spend 1 threat for an extra die.
He roars at it as it comes in.
Tries to gore you with 3d20. Hit.
Oh.
I get a threat back. Damage. 5, 6 damage. Knocking you, immediately. You're injured now. Basically, the thing comes and gores Kalesh in the side and throws him some ways across the chamber, and he falls to the ground bleeding unconscious. You have 1 injury.
Seeing one of her crewmen in trouble, Tla will charge in and try to slay the Targ.
Yep. That's 1 momentum and a hit. 6 damage.
Plus the vicious.
So that's 9 damage. Not enough to kill it. But you, it's you hit it, and right in the side, you feel all the, ribs break, and it's near death, certainly.
She pulls her batleth back out of it, some entrails sticking to it. Finish him!
Okay. Epek doesn't really need any encouragement. Run up and hack this guy.
Just so you know, when the scene changes, you lose 1 momentum automatically. So if you don't use this momentum, you lose it.
Oh.
So use it.
Could we use it to patch up Kalesh?
I don't think there's maybe. Yeah, you could on a medicine roll, potentially.
Yeah, I'd rather try and patch up.
Yep, that's fine. That is fine, yep. That's a hit, and you gain 1 momentum. It's dead.
I assume our medic is down.
Yeah, well, it's Tala honestly turns her back on that. She trusts her uncle to be able to dispatch it, and she's already headed over. She'll try to do first aid. She's got some medical.
I think somebody has decent medicine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Udaza, she comes up looking down on Kalesh. Let me fix this.
Do a good job. He fought bravely.
Daring plus medicine Difficulty 1. This will save his life.
So daring plus medicine. Okay.
Yep.
Can I assist?
Yeah, you can assist and add 1 die.
Okay, and we've got the momentum too.
Yep.
If you want to roll first, and then I'll use the momentum as well. Oh, there's 2 momentum?
Yeah, there's 2 momentum in the pool. Can you guys see the Klingon sign? Yeah, the blue bar is the momentum.
Alright, I'll use a momentum then.
You might as well use both of them, because one's going to go away anyway.
Only can use... It's either 1 or 3, so...
Oh, that's true. That's true, unless you give me threat. But, mm-hmm. Yeah. Good point.
Is it difficulty 1?
It is. Mm-hmm. So you gain a momentum back. You can roll that D... Did you roll the D20? Slip.
Oh, no, I didn't. I'm sorry. Hold on.
You're okay. Oh, well, let's wonder. That's a success, too, so that's another momentum.
Nice.
You're right there, Wand?
Yeah. Sorry, my Discord was playing up.
No, you're fine.
I could hear a thing from roll 20.
Very good. So how do you patch Kalesh up? He's still injured, but you're able to get him, you're able to stabilize him and all that stuff.
Yeah, Udaza, she, if there's a way, she probably has something, some sort of tool, and she basically takes a piece of metal that she might have, she might find on the floor, even something that she carries with her, and she heats it up, it's very hot, and she sees the gash in his side, and she's trained in field medicine, not, you know, stitching or anything like that. So she presses the heated metal to his side, searing and burning the skin closed, so the wound is sealed.
God, I love that gif.
That was incredibly brave. Be sure it scars well.
Can the first aid help anybody else who was injured? Or
stress goes back to maximum after a combat.
Gotcha. Tola pulls out a jar, thing of red paste from her own medicine kit, and starts to slather it on Kalesh's wounds. This will make a proud scar.
Does the pain of the searing bring Kalesh round?
Oh yeah, you wake up. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Kalesh wakes and he's like roaring in pain. And he looks up and sees Udaza leaning over him and smells his own flesh burning, and he kind of snarls at her, not in a, you know, just in a kind of
a nice snarl,
acknowledging the pain and acknowledging that she's giving him this honor of like giving him a big scar there, and but you know, he's not going to acknowledge it in a passive way. He's acknowledging it in a Klingon way.
And Udaza stands back to her feet and gives a nod and acknowledgement to Kalesh. You live to fight another day.
Ah, thank you. I should have killed it quicker. I was having too much fun. Thank you, and thank you, Commander.
I don't know what the Klingon word for wrestler is, but from now on, Ipek calls Kalesh Targ Wrestler.
Which has another sort of implication in there.
Fighting words.
Atlas.
So you guys can try to heal the injury permanently as well, which takes a control plus medicine roll against a difficulty of 3. You have some time, if you would like.
Sure.
You have 3 momentum, too. So.
Mm-hmm. I can definitely do that.
I'll assist again.
Okay.
I guess Udaz,
watch for onrushing targs or displaced temporal warriors.
What's your medicine roll? Your medicine plus control, Tala.
Oh, my medicine plus control.
Yeah.
It is 7 plus 3, 10.
Yeah, that's a fail on you.
So I'll spend all 3 momentum, so I have 40, 20.
Yep. Okay, and you generated 1 momentum, and so you're able to basically do a makeshift surgery on him. The pain is still there, Kalesh, but you're not, even after, like, we'll say it takes like a half an hour as she's digging around in your skin and your flesh, getting out all the infected kind of inflected tissue from the targ, the dirty targ horn.
Yeah, she rips open the wound again, using kind of her own blade. Oh gosh, what is it called? Her mechlith, to cut it back open, and then sticks her hand in there and just starts tearing out the infected flesh.
Kalesh is, you know, just trying to make sure he withstands the pain, you know, with true Klingon bravery. And he seems to appreciate that she's showing him the respect of realizing he can take this. You do start to think that maybe he's actually becoming attracted to her.
Of course he is. He wouldn't. Yeah, she's very, very neutral. She digs it out, but she does look to Kalesh as her hand is deep inside the wound, digging out the...
no wonder he's attracted to her!
She says, any lesser man would have passed up by now. Good job.
He snarls up at her and says, thank you! I feel better. And he tries to, it's probably too soon to stand up, but he forces himself to stand up, and he stands up and examines his new scar, and yeah, he really wants to lean back against the bulkhead near him, but he forces himself to stand up.
Tala pulls out a little canteen of Klingon liquor, hands it to him.
We must not waste any more time here.
Thank you. And he's always been fond of drinking before battle or before sentry duty or
blood wine
before a sensor sweep. So yeah, he has a good swig.
Before having a shower, before going like a man,
before heading to the bar.
You gotta at least have 3 goblets before of blood sleeping. Wine before active duty, or you're in dereliction.
No fucking Klingon.
Yeah.
Gotta take the edge off. Yeah.
Yeah, you see kind of now that the battle has subsided. There is a walkway on the other side that heads into a central chamber. You can kind of even smell from here this incense that's heavy in the air, that you can smell kind of wafting in from that area.
Now that the scent of Kalesh's flesh is not so heavy in the air, I believe I detect a more delicate aroma.
I guess we head that way.
Yeah. We're following you, Commander.
Yeah, which way are we going?
You're going to another screen.
Oh.
You head through this kind of walk walkway. And you see there's this old woman kind of standing in the middle of this chamber. You see on the right and left of you kind of drops down into nothing. You see like there's flickering lights down below. The woman is kneeling facing you. There's a Batleth and a Mechleth kind of out in front of her on these ornamental stands. Her eyes are closed. She seems like she's in a deep meditative state. She doesn't say anything just yet.
Have we heard any stories about... Or is there any known protocol?
What you know about her is that she was once, her and her brother were, basically, they had started they were a part of like a civil war, which is not uncommon for the houses of the Klingons. And her brother was probably going to become chancellor, but, generals under his command, revolted and killed him, and she was able to kill all the mutineers, if you will, and in her sadness she retired here instead of going for the chancellorship herself, and she's stayed here in contemplation for almost 100 years. There's no decorum about how to address her or anything that you know of, besides normal social structures of Klingons.
Right. Talal will walk to the edge of that platform and say loudly a formal Klingon greeting.
Glorathal, we have come to seek thy blessing and thy wisdom. We have fought our way through the asteroid field and the challenges here.
One thing you notice is in the corner there are like two targs that are basically leashed to a massive pole. And the Oracle opens her eyes slightly.
Good! I am glad that you have bested the Targs and the asteroid field. It proves your worth.
Her eyes open slowly as she says this.
Such is my lifetime call, to prove my worth to the entire fleet. I may give you my blessing, although you will be the last that receives it, as the old days are returning, and I will soon, my song will end.
Glory to thy house, Glorathar. It is our honor to receive our final blessing.
She waves you forward. Go ahead.
Kalesh waits for his commander to finish speaking and then says to Glorathar,
"You say that your time is ending. Is this related to the Chroniton decay I have detected?"
You are a smart one then. Yes, the Chronotons are soon to be gone, and they will return. And as fierce as I will be and fight them, it would be just I against the traitors. And I will be slain, and my song will end.
Talaha looks back at the others, and then back at Glorathar.
No true Klingon could take and then leave knowing that an honored one such as you would be facing certain death without throwing their own sword into the fray? Who are these traitors you speak of?
Traitors to the Empire. But I will tell you my full tale so you can choose. My brother, he was destined to become Chancellor with Thai at his side as a trusted advisor. But we were close to defeating the rival houses. But instead, he chose that he would execute all the other house heads, not just those that rose up against us. I could not convince him otherwise, and I slew him.
And this is completely different than anything you had ever heard.
When his troops came to find me,
she nods kind of behind you,
I used that machine to use the Clartons to send most of the army back in time, stuck in a temporal rift, while I and my armies defeated the rest. But now they are decaying, and it will end with their armies coming here very soon. And I will fight, and my song will end one way or another. I grow tired of this place, in solitude until someone comes every few years, passing the test as you have. The last to be given my blessing. Come forth and speak your names.
Talaha comes forward and says, I am Commander Talaha of the Blackbird.
And she kind of kneels one knee before Glorathar, but, you know, looks her in the eye.
She takes her sword in her hand and brings it across your cheek, not so deeply to cut anything but your skin, but as she cuts your cheek, she does it in a certain pattern. You're not exactly sure offhand what it is, but she makes this very precise pattern on your cheek.
Rise with my blessing, whatever you decide. But realize that soon they will come.
Talaha opens her mouth to ask another question, but realizes that the others deserve their blessing and steps aside.
Epic kneels. Epic, son of Voss, first officer of the Nutka.
Ah, Epic, I see great things in your future. Strong and wise.
And she marks the marking. It's slightly different than Talaha, but similar, very similar, into your cheek.
Rise, stand with honor and glory for the Empire.
Could stand by his niece's side.
And Kalesh will step forward and kneel before her.
I am Lieutenant Commander Kalesh, also of the Blackbird.
I see you have suffered a wound from my pets. It is good.
Ah, yes. I will bear it with honor.
She gives you a marking, similar, also slightly different, and she smiles.
A brush with death is a great, great reward.
He gives her a toothy, fierce grin.
Thank you.
She looks past you to Azaha.
Daza steps up and kneels as well.
I am Ambassador Udaza to the Chancellor.
She looks a little... You catch that she gives you a bit of a surprised look. The Chancellor herself... Or, I guess she doesn't say... The Chancellor sent their own emissary here.
Indeed, he has.
Ah, then receive your blessing. And she gives one on the left cheek and one on the right cheek differently. For those that can read Klingon, one is to Udaza herself and one appears to be to the Chancellor. As the blood kind of congeals in the small cuts. What is it you do here with these crewmen of the Blackbird?
I watch and I observe as decreed by the Chancellor.
She looks at you for a moment. Make sure the Chancellor is wise.
They are, indeed.
Ah, good. Will you stand with me and fight then? This relic of old that will soon be here. Or will you go? It is up to you. I bear no malice either way.
Is she speaking to all of us? Yeah, still? Talaha looks at Epic and Kalesh. I mean, she knows what she wants to say, but she looks at Kalesh's wound and then reassures her of their courage.
Of course, Glortha, as I said, no true Klingon could leave one honored one such as yourself to face so many alone, especially when there's such glory to be had in the battle.
Today is a good day to die.
And as Epic is saying that, Kalesh kind of joins him and kind of intoning it.
What of you, Daza, Ambassador to Chancellor?
Talaha looks at her with like genuine interest in what her answer is going to be.
It would be a dishonor to leave now and not stand and fight.
Indeed, we stay. How many do we face?
I do not know how many will come through the temple rifts, but it will happen soon. And she looks around almost expecting it to happen right away, but it doesn't exactly.
Talaha starts passing around the blood wine. Each sip getting there, blood flowing hotter.
What do you mean, sip?
Well, you gotta save some for the rest of us, Kalesh.
She says,
he gets the laugh.
Tell me your greatest victories.
Talaha comes forward and she says,
when Epic son of Vos suffered a grave injury, the Blackbird was threatened by some upstart unworthy of the rank. Instead, I took command, snatching victory from the grasp of that unworthy person. But perhaps that victory was not so great as when we conquered the Great Plague.
She tells the story about, you know, that infection that swept through and leaving few to survive, but those who did were the strong ones, leaving the Klingon Empire even stronger for it.
Yeah, she seems very pleased by this. A worthy tale. And she looks like she's going to say something else, and her, you all get this kind of sense of something's about to happen. She ducks her head suddenly as a batlift kind of swings overhead and just misses her just by a fraction as all these Klingons come out of this temporal rift suddenly at the same time all around you. And I will let you... I'm going to... let me see what Seize the Initiative is, because that's what I'm going to try to do. Man, this PDF is super slow. We can take a 5-minute break if you'd like.
Sure.
I'll be back.
Yep.
What make tea this time?
Oh my gosh. Yeah, so Raven, retain the initiative is when you, because I just read it, is when you are about ready to give over the initiative back to the other side. You basically, one player can go again.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. I don't see a seize the initiative in here, though. I'm trying to remember, but I thought at least in Conan, it's definitely a little different. I can spend a threat to have a guy go before you. Let me see if I can find my threat spins in here anywhere. It's just been a little bit. And Star Trek has a little less crunchy combat system, so it might not be valid. Combat. Oh man. Spinning through it. There we go.
Where's determination spends?
Determination spends are when you challenge basically, so the way that works is you look at your values. If you can challenge one of your values, now this is Star Trek. This is like the Star Trek. It might be different for Klingons, which it very much could be. But in the normal Star Trek, it's when you challenge one of your values, like do the opposite of it.
Really?
Then you get to use a determination, and determinations give you a, it's as if you roll an extra die as a one. So if you have a focus, it's going to be two successes immediately. So we'll just go by that rule. Just give me a sec. I'm just looking at, trying to find my threat spins. Very good.
I think make that would be reversed from.
That's kind of what I thought. There's, I guess I cannot grab the initiative.
Like one of mine is never back down. I can't imagine that I get a determination spend if I back down.
Right.
Okay, there's dispending determination. I wonder if it is different.
I have determined to flee. I will roll an extra die.
Well, it could be something like in combat, yeah, but like in like
I'm being
yeah, yeah. It could be useful out, like somebody challenges you something that maybe is not best for
you.
You know.
Right, that would make sense.
Here we go. You can spend determination by saying one of your values that supports your action. You're taking a point of the spins. Yeah, it's actually going with it instead of against it.
So doing something that goes with your values gives you determination.
Yeah. You can spend determination by saying one of your values that supports the actions you are taking. The point of determination spend provide. Yeah. It's different. Yeah, so you can do automatic success, reroll. You can do an additional task. You can ignore an injury. It's on page 79 of the Klingon core book, if you guys have that handy. But yeah, that's what it does. Okay, we can get started. I think everybody's back. Is everybody back?
They're all. Mm-hmm.
Matt, are you back?
Yep.
Okay. All right, it is your turn, so go ahead. Whoever wants to go first as these guys come in.
Udaza will jump into the fray, assuming that Glorathar has the general here. She will she'll take out her... Oh, goodness. Her Mechleth.
Okay.
And she'll jump on this time displaced warrior.
Yes. That's a hit.
Ha ha.
That's a hit. These guys have resistance one. So that is 7 damage. This is going to be 6 damage after it's all done with.
Sweet. And I'll spend that momentum that I gained to reroll those 2 dice.
Yeah. Bring that out. Whoops. Okay. Down to 0 momentum now. So that's 2 more damage. So what did I say? I was 7, so 9 minus what? So 8 damage. Yeah, you cut him across the arm, and you can just tell he's got his he's got a Mechleth out.
Udaza, as she literally jumps to him, roars in excitement for the coming battle, and seeing his blood just makes her more excited, more determined.
Is it?
Kalesh calls out to the commander so that she can see what he's doing, and then as this warrior next to him tries to attack him, he sidesteps, if he can go this far,
sure.
and takes a shot at this guy over here so that the commander can hopefully charge in at him.
Yeah, as you move away, coward with your gun! Fight me hand to hand!
And that way, hopefully, he'll be facing an opponent he's not expecting. All right.
He does call you a coward as you move away. Oh, wow. So that's, you generate 2 momentum from that.
Whew. Great. Don't roll damage. Can I re-roll 3 of those?
Do you want to?
That's really good.
That's
really
good. You don't have any blanks. Right? So that's 9 damage right there.
Oh, okay, so I just seen 6. Yeah, okay.
I'll because for every effect, that's the Star Trek sign. So every of those, you get an extra damage for vicious.
Cool.
I mean, you. So here's a momentum spend you can make. If you look at under that combat PC, so it should say momentum spends, and there should be a
create an opportunity that could like represent what you just did.
Create an opportunity is an extra die. But you can where's the so pass an action order to another end. So you can only be done once before the enemy. So you can do keep the initiative. So when you're done attacking, you give one of your people another attack. Or you can just do bonus damage. So you rolled 9 damage, right? But you can, for every momentum you can spend, you can just tack on another damage if you want. So he took 9, right? You rolled a 9. He has 1 resistance, so he took 8. So he's at you hit him square in the chest, but he's not dead.
Okay. Now I was trying to give an advantage to the captain by giving him an opening on this guy behind me. So if I can do that.
I'll let you do an assist.
Okay. It says over on create opportunity. That
create opportunity just means you get to keep an extra die. Yeah, that's when you use momentum to add another die. That's what that is.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. So I'll do the assist then.
Yeah, sure. We can do that. Why not? Or you could do actually another thing. You can do a swift task, which means you can attack again, but it's a 3 difficulty. I'm just giving.
Whatever. Yeah, I'd go for it. That seems better.
But the difficulty is 3 instead on this one. But you can use your momentum too. So.
Yeah, because I've got 2 momentum from that, right? So I could use 1 of them on this. Yeah, I think I'll do that. I'll do that swift attack and use 1 of the momentum.
Okay, so that, well, swift attack costs 2 momentum, and you're going to use an additional. So that would be at 0 to do it. So maybe you don't want to do that. That would be a tough one.
Yeah. Now I'll just leave it, and I'll assist the commander as she goes.
Okay, that's fine. We'll do that. You can spend a momentum to do that. That's fine. So you get to do an assist.
He just rolls a d20.
Yeah, we'll just do it that way. Why not? Yeah, that's good. That would be a success.
All right. So, Talaha, grinning widely, Batleth had already been ready, kind of gives a Kalesh that appreciative smile as she charges forward toward this guy.
So 1 success already.
Yeah. So, Batleth.
That's a hit. Go ahead and roll damage. Ooh.
Ooh, can I?
Yeah, you can. You can spend 1 momentum to reroll 4 dice. Yep.
Okay.
What's your skills? You can use those
challenge.
Yeah, so no, but yeah, we'll figure it out. The four is definitely hit with focus, so that's two. The nine's a hit, so that's... So, yeah, you're going to have to roll the challenge dice again because it's not a d20, right? You're re-rolling the d6s. There you go. Gotcha. So,
so that's
six.
Another two.
Yeah,
that's
six damage. So he takes
one,
five.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Because it's vicious. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Oh, yep. Six
five,
plus
six, seven,
eight.
Eight.
Eight. Yep. Eight, yep.
Yeah.
So, okay. Yeah, you hit him across the chest with your bat left, and he, like, teeters on the edge, and, I'll kill you, traitor! And, I believe it is Epek's turn.
And so he will rush this guy.
Yeah, let me get you that bow. That's a miss and a complication. I'll just take the threat for now. Let me give you this step out real quick. Okay, so you miss and I take the threat. Alright, I have 11 threat now. I think everybody has acted correct. Yeah, I'm gonna spend six threat. Well, not yet. First, Glorathar is going to attack Jenner Gruth, and she attacks with her Batleth. That's a hit. You don't get momentum for her attacks. Roll damage 8, 10. Minus his one. Yeah, she hits him hard. She moves at bewildering speed for someone of her age, and she sticks him in the stomach with her Batleth edge, and you hear, oh! Kind of screams out. Preternatural speed indeed. And, he returns the attack. He's going to attack with his Batleth. He's going to spend one threat. And he misses. He swings back and just whiffs over her head. In combat right now, this displaced warrior that got shot by the disruptor charges Kalesh. And he's going to attack with his weapon. Does he really only have that? One second. Yeah, he has a... Yeah, actually, he's going to stop here and shoot with his disruptor. I'm going to spend a threat to give him three dice. He misses. Yes, one sec. You should have sight on Matt. He misses. This Disruptor 2... one attacks Talah with his dagger. I'll spend a threat on him as well.
Ouch.
Okay. So that's two threat to me. Rolling damage. Only two. I'm going to... I'm going to add... So those things vicious they are. So that's four damage. I'm going to just spend three threat for three additional damage. So you take seven. Yeah, he cuts you across the stomach with it. Time to place warrior, displaced warrior 4, attacks you Daza, with his dagger. I'm going to spend one threat. That's a hit.
Uh-oh.
4 damage. We're just going to go with that against you. How's that look? Is he...
So he is... She's nearly on top, just stabbing down at him. He takes out his dagger and gets her right in the side. And she growls with pain, but just adding more fuel to the fire for her.
Yeah, Epic, the warrior you're fighting, attempts to stab you with his dagger. I'm going to spend a threat to do so. That's a miss with a complication. I'm going to give you guys a momentum for that. So, and I believe it is your turn now.
I think Kalesh, you can. We're just going in the same order. I think that was you first.
Okay, cool. Thank you. So he's going to. He's just sort of dodging about here, trying to make himself a harder target, and he will fire his disruptor.
Roll damage. That's a hit. That is 7 damage. That's enough to kill him. You hit this ancient Klingon from another era and then hit him square in the chest and it just poof, disappears.
Yell a roar of triumph and turn around to look for another target.
Okay, who's next?
Talaha will make use of her warrior spirit. So I'll give you 2 threat to get an extra dice.
Yes, you can do that.
And there is a... She can re-roll a miss, I think, with that ability when she spends threat.
Okay. That's a hit.
Nine?
That is 9, yes. So he takes 8 damage that kills him. How's that look?
Yeah, she faints toward him and then leans back as if leaving her belly open and unprotected for another jab, knowing he's going to take it. And as he does, she sweeps in from the side and takes him in the neck. And pulls out her batleth as he kind of disappears into the time continuum.
Udaza.
All right. So with that dagger digging into her side, she's going to swipe down at the time displaced warrior with her mechleth. And let's see. I might do the similar thing. Oh, we have momentum.
You have 1. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So, I'll just, I won't use it, but I'll attack.
Okay. Hit.
Ah.
5.
That's
enough to kill him.
So you don't have to. Oh, sweet.
Yeah, it has the look.
Yeah, she just bears down on him using all her weight, just to stab down, grabbing the hilt of her mechleth with both hands and digging it into his chest, twisting it around as he screams. They slowly fade as he bleeds out onto the ground and disappears.
Epic, son of Voss.
Having blocked the time displaced warrior's strike, swings his batleth.
Hit. 8 damage. So he's going to take 7 of that. Would you like to use a momentum to reroll any dice?
Yes.
That's 4 dice. Yeah.
That seems worthwhile.
Yeah.
Challenge dice.
Oh, brother. That is... Wow. That's 14 damage.
Wow.
How do you kill him?
Epic roars as he swings the bat lift and it comes down, catches the guy sort of in the collarbone, splits deep into his chest.
The Oracle goes to attack the general, but as this happens, I'm going to spend... how many do I have? I'm going to spend 6 threat. And more of these warriors come out of the time stream.
They're giants.
Yeah, he's huge, man. Huge.
Grew him big back in the day.
Yeah. Humbug!
They're so small now.
Comes here and... And then as she does that, she attacks Jenner Gruff with her Batleth. That's a hit. Oh, yeah. She twirls around her Batleth with preternatural speed and ability and brings it the tip down on this man's forehead, crushing through his brow ridges like it was nothing. And as she pulls it out, she kicks him in the chest and his body falls down the edge of the platform where you're standing and crashes to the ground below, killing him. And then the time displaced warriors scream out and tear. One charges Yudaza. I'm going to spend a threat on this attack because he has a disruptor. He's going to just shoot.
Coward!
Yeah. Miss. It just goes wide over your head. Two is going to attack with his dagger since he's in close. No threat to spend. Miss. The other one attacks Epic with his dagger. And... Miss. They're all, like, flailing at you, but missing. And you're up.
Tala, wanting to make the most of this, this battle without, any, historical, you know, comparison, something that'll go down in the memory of the Klingons. She's going to spend a point of determination, glory in battle.
Yes.
And apply that toward this attack. So that's a automatic one.
Yep,
success,
so that's
right?
Two successes immediately.
Right, so I'll just roll damage.
No, well, you roll. You roll your normal attack. You can get up to, you know, whatever. 6 successes, technically. Because you could generate complication, too, and all that jazz, yeah. So that is 4 successes. You generate 2 momentum. Now you can roll damage. That's 9 damage right there.
And how many momentum do we have?
You have 2, because you just generated it.
I think I'm going to go for a swift attack with one of those.
Yeah, well, it costs 2 swift attack.
Oh,
it costs two.
Yeah, I'm going to go for it.
So he's down to 3. So go ahead. This is a difficulty 3. So... And you're only rolling 2 dice, so keep that in mind. You gotta get focus. Yeah, the second one misses, so how does it look if you hit with the first but miss with the second?
Yeah, she goes in just charging, sticks her batleth in, hits him in the side, pulls it out, and wanting to make a quick end of this this warrior and perhaps get some action on another guy, she goes for another quick jab, but he manages to back up out of the way of the blade, and she resteadies her stance, hissing through her teeth.
Who's up?
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, after you.
All right. Udaza, she yells at the warrior who shot at her, "Fight me like a warrior!" And she charges with her Mekleth, doing the same, jumping across the room to attempt to engage.
Okay.
And you know what? I'm gonna buy a threat because I have the to battle ability, which gives me bonus momentum for rerolling damage, I think.
Okay, I'll take the threat.
Whew!
So is it rerolling attack, or...?
No, I think it's only a bonus momentum that I only can use. Let's see, each threat you add to the Game Master's pool, you gain one bonus momentum that may only be spent on bonus damage, increasing the damage of the attack by one per momentum spent.
Yeah, so you swing and he's able to just duck out of the way at the last moment. Kalesh, what would you like to do?
Okay, he's going to join her in shooting at this guy. Oh, actually, I think she's got that guy, so he's going to turn around and just get he was squaring up on this guy, now he's going to try and take the guy sort of behind him, number two, by surprise by suddenly whirling and shooting at him.
Okay. Miss. Yeah, you shoot high this time, and Epic Son of Us, you're up. I'll take the threat. Yeah. How does it look as you kind of stumble and totally miss terribly? Okay. There's a miss there. Okay, I'm gonna... Glorathar, she kind of stands back and she just yells out, "For your glory, fight them!" She doesn't appear that she's interested in jumping in. She's gonna let you have the rest of the glory for the fight. I'm gonna spend two threat to bring in another warrior.
Kalesh needs a dancing partner.
Yeah. He drops right in front of Kalesh, obviously. And as he comes through the time stream, he immediately attacks Kalesh with... actually, he just drops right here, and he just points and fires at Kalesh's head. Hit.
Oh.
8 damage. Hits you right in the chest, and you just, burns a hole through your jerkin there.
Flash yells in pain and prepares to fire back.
Let's see. The time displaced warrior that had the disruptor points it kind of in melee combat and tries to shoot Udaza. Miss.
Yeah, she bats it out of the way.
Facing the captain, this one attacks with his dagger viciously, but will he hit? He will! He does hit. I get a threat. Only 1 damage. That is uncool. I'm going to re-roll. Man, can that even be right? So, combat dice 2. Where is the challenge dice? There it is. 2. Okay, so that is actually 3-4 damage. Yeah, he stabs you in the side, kind of.
She grunts takes some of the blood, wipes it on her brow bone and what the I can't think of the
brow
word.
Ridges. I don't know. That's what
brow
I call it.
Head ridges.
Brow bone. All right. Time to displace warrior 3 attacks boss with his dagger. Miss and a complication. I'll give you a momentum. Yeah, he swings and kind of slips. There's just... these guys are not doing so good down in that corner. And it is your turn.
I'll attack. Yeah.
Well, that is good. That is 2 momentum immediately. Oh my gosh. Well, he's definitely dead.
Yeah, she was just toying with him. She wanted him to feel good about himself before she killed him.
Holy crap.
He hits her, and she just smiles at him, and as he lunges forward again, feeling overconfident from that previous graze, she swings the bat left behind her head and over in front of her, and just takes him in the torso again, almost cutting him in half.
Yeah, blood just, and viscera just go everywhere.
Kapla!
Who's next?
Apex snarls at his guy, swings again.
That's 6 damage. You have 3 momentum.
Yeah, let's spend one.
Reroll. Reroll 4.
Nice.
9. 8 damage. So you hit him really hard that time. Cut him across the chest. He staggers, but doesn't quite fall down. He's up.
Kalesh will draw a bead on the warrior number 4. He's gonna stand his ground.
Fire.
Actually, can I spend a momentum?
Yes, of course.
Cool.
Roll me 3 dice. Oh my goodness.
Ooh. Oh, so nice.
Oh, 3 momentum gain there. Alright, well, that's 10 damage right away. Anything you want to do with momentum after hitting him for 10 damage? It'd be 9 damage because he's got armor.
No, I'll leave that for the others.
Yeah, you hit him straight in the chest, but just so you know, you could spend 2 momentum just for... you could re-roll, or you could just... you can just go... you can spend a momentum per damage, so you could just give him 2 damage on top of what you did for 2 momentum. You have 4 momentum in the pool, just so you know.
Yeah, let's do that.
So, yeah, how does that kill him as you...
Kalesh had been kind of moving and trying to make himself a hard target, but he just, with this guy appeared, he just stopped and set his feet widely and faced him and just shot him straight in the chest, and then he roars in triumph as the guy just disintegrates.
Mm-hmm. Udaza.
All right, she's gonna keep going after this guy in front of her, attempting to... stab him in the gut
We have two momentum.
I'll spend one.
Okay. Yeah. He is able to parry it with his dagger, and he like gets really close to you and just blah, kind of screams in your face, and he tries to kind of pull you forward and stab you in the stomach at the same time with his dagger. I don't have any threat, so there's 2d20 at you. Hit.
Ooh.
6 damage. Didn't generate. Yeah, so he basically takes his dagger and just drives it into your side. Oh, whoops, that was wrong. That was me. Yeah, it hurts very badly. Puts you down to 3.
Daza roars out in pain, but seems to be enjoying the fight. Finally says, now you fight me like a warrior.
He just tries to dig in the blade as the other warrior attacks Epic. With his 2d20 focus, yes. Hit. Only 4 damage there. So you take 4. Yeah, he cuts you across the leg, Epic, but it's probably too little too late for him. But he's going down like a Klingon warrior regardless, and you guys are up.
I think Tala kind of stands in between Kalesh and Epic, signaling his kill. And she looks over at the ambassador, who seems to be much closer to actually being in trouble. So she kind of weighs the rudeness of interfering in her mind, but decides to take an attack.
Okay.
Can she use her disruptor?
Yeah, sure. That's fine. It's a move action to flip them, but we don't. You're all in one zone, so it doesn't matter. Go ahead. That's a hit with 1 momentum.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Yep.
Had he been hit already?
No.
I thought he did at least once when she first charged at him.
Do you know how much damage you did to him?
I have
no
idea.
We'll just say sure. You disintegrate him. How's it look?
Alright, she kind of almost casually points her disruptor at him and shoots him, and as he kind of dissipates, she looks over at Udaza and makes a gesture that's kind of like the equivalent of my pardon. Because it's a little bit rude.
And with only... Yeah, go ahead.
So there is a snarl from Udaza at that, but she accepts the intrusion.
And with only 1 Klingon warrior facing Epic, what do you do, Epic?
Oh, he will absolutely try to kill this
guy. And you have 2 momentum in the pool. You can use 1 for an extra die if you want.
Yeah, why not?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, nice.
Amazing.
That's gonna kill him. How does it look as you finish off the last one?
Wings low. Opens the guy's belly up. Entrails to spill on the floor.
And with that, no more Klingon warriors seem to come out of the temporal rifts, leaving you standing around in victory.
Tala sort of gives everyone a, you know, a warrior's victory embrace, you know, like, you know, more of like clapping them on the shoulder and congratulating them on their new scars. But Glorathar, the traitors are all gone. What do you intend to do?
As I said, my song is ended. I will go from this place into space.
Your life might be over, Glorathar, but we will sing your song so that it is never forgotten.
She gives a slight nod. Your glory begins here. Kapla!
Kapla!
And I kind of envision all of you, like, tilting your head back at the same time.
Yeah. Well, echoing it, yeah.
Yeah.
She, after you're done celebrating your victory, she lays down her batliff and her sword.
Gifts for the victors, for you, for I will not need them anymore.
And she gives over her weapons, her ancient, well-made batliff and mekleth. And she turns without another word and heads off into the adjoining walkway on the other side and disappears. Sometime later, you would know that a shuttle can be seen leaving the base and just kind of goes deeper into the asteroid belt until it's no longer seen or scans can find it. And I'll leave you guys for some closing roleplay as you've gotten the blessing of the Oracle and defeated the ancient Klingon warriors.
I think Tala sits for a moment admiring the make of these ancient weapons, pondering how she's going to record this in her captain's log.
So, Daza, what will you tell your chancellor?
Udaza, she's just kind of got two of her fingers, and she's looking at her wound, prodding it, and just examining, trying to assess how the scar is going to look afterwards. She looks up to the commander.
Well, I will assure you the chancellor will be most pleased with this report.
She grunts in satisfaction, looks between the batleth and the mekleth, and holds it out to the mekleth out to Udaza.
For the chancellor, or you, as she sees fit.
Udaza takes it and examines it, nodding to Talaha.
Thank you. This will be very fine gift for the Chancellor.
And Talaha looks at Epic.
And someday, when our house has an heir,
she holds out the batleth,
this will go to him.
And she looks over at Kalesh.
I think your batleth needs a new insignia. That of a Targ.
Flesh gives her a toothy grin.
Yes, I need to kill a few more. That one almost got the better of me. We can't be having that.
And as you consider your futures after the glory you have won here in Baklath Reach and the stories that you will tell and the glory given to your family, you beam up back to your ship And that is the end of the episode. We're done.
Kabla! Kabla!
And thank you for playing.
That was fun. You gotta play it differently than you do, like, if you're in the Starfleet. Like, does my friend need help? I mean, is he gonna be pissed if I help him?
You're a bunch of dorks. You're a bunch of dorks.
Oh, we're a bunch of dorks for talking about Klingons, but you can recite Tolkien poetry, and you're very cool.
I almost just posted... I know the seven sons of Fëanor.
Definitely not dorky.